Okay, so let's start with the webinar. Today, the webinar is about water, environment, and community engagement through citizen science. We have different presenters. So we have a lot of presenters today. We have Sofia Mojica from Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona, myself, Susana Toboso, also from the Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona. Then we have Fiona Regan from the Dublin City University and Brish Kesey from the Dublin City University as well. And then we have Pedro Besa and Monica Aresta from the University of Aveiro. So we have a lot of different presentations. So the questions and the debate will be after all the presentations. Okay, so Sofia will start with the first presentation talking about the SMART-ER project. So Sofia, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Okay, so I will present the opportunities of the SMART-ER project, which is in the framework of ECIU University. So the ECIU Consortium was founded in 1997, and the name underlines the European dimension of a selected group of entrepreneurial universities. And we remain dedicated to ensuring a culture of innovation in all of our institutions and to providing a catalytic role for innovation and fit in business and society at large. ECIU University, which started in 2019, is an agile open agora of the European at the European level for solving multidisciplinary societal challenges, doing research and learning for life. We create a model of a true European university for the benefit of European society. The Research Institute for Smart European Regions, SMART-ER, which started in 2021, is a research, innovation, and education strong alliance enabling to jointly address complex societal challenges under the framework of SDG 11, Sustainable Cities and Communities. Jointly, the institutions will pilot capacity building programs such as the SEED program and the SMART-ER Academy and citizen science initiatives that will be used as a testbed to put into practice all the mechanisms and structures built. The ECIU University Research Institute is a new model of barrier-free research and innovation based on a virtual collaboration environment. It's a framework for joint research that delivers solutions to current and future SDG 11 challenges, and it involves science-society cooperation and citizen science initiatives in practice to help overcome the limitations of disciplines, sectors, and countries. The objectives of the Research Institute are to maximize research collaboration, to share research infrastructure, to create a rewarding environment for researchers, and to empower public engagement. The first phase of the ECIU University focuses on the Sustainable Development Goal 11, which is sustainable cities and communities. And then on citizen science, I can say that citizen science is a pillar for the public engagement of ECIU universities by integrating the stakeholders in the process, including public administration, the private sector, the civil society, and the academia. ECIU will promote the consolidation of a strong community of citizen science, aiming to contribute to the challenge-based approach for learning and research. And the different ways of implementation of citizen science at ECIU will contribute to make ECIU universities places to which people can return once finished their degrees, positioning ECIU as a lifelong learning instrument for positive and transformative social impact. So here you have the timing for the citizen science actions of the SMART-ER project. So here you can see that we are on the phase of the webinars in citizen science, and then which will be running until January. And then during the first week of February, we will organize a workshop to co-create proposals for citizen science pilots. And then during next year, the pilots will be designed, and during the second half of the year, these pilots will be running and concluded in 2023. So now I give the floor to Susana. She holds a bachelor's degree in environmental science and a master's in interdisciplinary studies in environmental, economic, and social sustainability, with a specialization in urban and industrial ecology, and a PhD in environmental science and technology from the University Autonoma of Barcelona. So, so the floor is yours, Susana. You can share your slides now, and just present your presentation.
Thank you, Fiona. Sophia. Just one second.
Yes, I stopped presenting.
Okay. Can you see my presentation?
Not yet.
No.
We see blank.
Now? No, because I'm seeing my presentation. Okay, let's do it again.
Yeah.
Now you are seeing my presentation. Yeah? No?
No.
Okay. I close and I open again.
Yes.
Maybe because I have double screen, I disconnect the other one.
Mm-hmm.
And now?
Yes.
Okay, so I disconnect the screen and now it's working. Yes?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. So thank you. Thank you very much. Let's start with my presentation. Today I will present a part of my research named the Water Energy Food Nexus Implementation on Rooftops, incorporating citizen science. So let me start presenting my research group, Sostenipra, that is a research group in the field of industrial ecology from the Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona. We work in different fields in industrial ecology, life cycle assessment, and sustainable cities, such as resource management for a circular economy or sustainable food systems or integrated systems analysis of urban nature-based solutions. So our research group mainly is a group dedicated to environmental analysis, environmental uses, issues. But also we have these different projects that you can see here that they are basically based on urban agriculture. For example, we have the Groove project that is based on how to implement rooftop greenhouses in our buildings. And also, for example, the ERC Consolidator grant from our researcher, Gara Villalba, that is integrated system analysis of urban vegetation and agriculture. So mainly we analyze environmental impacts, environmental issues, but we started some years ago trying to introduce citizen science in our research. Because always with the environmental issues, also we have to have this social perspective. So we started introducing citizen science, such as, for example, social perception of new urban strategies or co-designing future scenarios with the residents of these municipalities that that we are analyzing. And also, for example, introducing food diaries in schools and high schools for analyzing the pattern consumptions of these stakeholders. So I will explain a case study that we have and we analyze. This case study is based on housing estates. In housing estates is these typical constructions of mid and high rise blocks that you can see here in these pictures. We have around 41 million people living in this kind of constructions, and they face usually many different environmental, social, and economic issues, such as low incomes or increasing unemployment, also some educational problems or social and racial tensions, and also conflicts. So the case study is Badia del Vallès, that is a municipality in Barcelona. It's a typical housing estate built in the 70s, with, you can see here, with these environmental, social, and economic issues, such as low income per capita. You can see the differences between Badia del Vallès and Barcelona. Also, they need a rehabilitation. Also, these constructions are subsidized until 2025. And usually in this municipality, they need around 30% of social services. And also they have some subsidized energy and water supply. So you can see here the objective. The objective for this study was to analyze the socioeconomic and environmental feasibility of the metabolic patterns of the food, energy, and water nexus, and then to assess the potential of the roof mosaic, which means to use the rooftops of our buildings to implement food, energy, and water in order to know to contribute to the local food, energy, and water sovereignty, and also self-sufficiency of this housing estate. So you can see here the methodology that we use and we incorporate in our citizen science, incorporate in our participatory integrated sustainability assessment. The first part was a participatory process with the residents of this municipality in order to design the future scenarios they want to implement on their rooftops, and also the indicators they were concerned and they were interested. After that, we perform a quantitative assessment. We use different methodologies to analyze the metabolism of the area and then to obtain environmental, social, and economic indicators. And when we have all these three different perspectives, the sustainability assessment, then we went also to the municipality, showing the different scenarios we propose based on their opinion, and they have to vote for they prefer option they want for their municipality. So you will see now the different participatory processes. The first one was the World Cafe method. The World Cafe method is a participatory process to create a safe and welcoming environment in which we can connect different ideas and perspectives and talk about the topic we want to talk. So we did this World Cafe method with different small groups, and they have to talk about their concerns, what they prefer for their municipality, and other things. So you can see here the different results of this participatory process with the residents of this municipality. You can see here that the main concern of this municipality was the social degradation and also the lack of social cohesion. They prefer mainly to implement on the rooftop energy production, such as PV panels, and also rainwater harvesting and food production. They found different barriers of using the rooftop, for example, the significant investment for these new systems, also the maintenance, who will take care of these systems, and also the lack of social cohesion in this municipality to take care of these new systems. But at the same time, they saw different opportunities such as money savings or resource savings. And mainly they prefer this kind of indicators, monetary savings, investment costs, and also maintenance costs. After that, with this, we propose five different scenarios, as you can see here, S1, S2, S3, S4, and S5. And here, this is the quantitative assessment. We propose different indicators based on the opinion of these residents, and we analyze the different scenarios. After having all these indicators, we did a second participatory process. It was an open exhibit with all the different different scenarios that you can see here. It was different posters, and the residents have 2 weeks to vote for their preferred option to implement on the rooftop on their municipality. So you can see here the different results of these five different scenarios. The first one is the implementation of PV panels in all the rooftops and rainwater harvesting. And it was the one that more people preferred. 65% prefer this option. And the second option was the combination of PV panels, photovoltaic panels, and also green roofs. And this option was voted only for 70%. And the rest of the option, scenario 3, 5, and 4, these are the different combinations with PV panels and open farming and also rooftop greenhouses. But these options were the least voted. So this research aimed to use rooftops for urban productivity of food, energy, and water. So cities in Zion was key in this study because rooftops are common spaces on residential buildings, which are currently unused. Therefore, citizen residents have to be part of this decision-making process. Also to involve neighbors in the decision-making of future sustainable scenarios for their municipality in order to be a successful projects. Also to choose the combination of different systems the residents will prefer to implement. So including their preferences and needs in climate change solutions. So in this case, citizens were part of this research, aiming to include their preferences and their concerns within a sustainability assessment of the implementation of the different systems on their roofs. So through the city council and also the different neighborhood associations, we conducted different participatory processes. So they were part of the whole process. First of all, a first participatory process to design these future scenarios, and then a second participatory process with all the information of these scenarios, and then they have to choose what they want for their municipality. So we are trying to further implement new participatory process and other types of methods to engage citizens in these relevant decisions related to environmental issues. And right now we have this project that we are we have in Cerdanyola del Vallès, and also we are trying to include citizen science and all these different social perspectives in order to have more successful projects. And that's it. This is my email. If you have any question later, I will answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Susana.
Okay.
Okay. Oh, wait. Okay, but thank you so
okay.
much. So
thank
now,
you.
Now,
yes.
Just so
okay.
you can continue.
Okay, so our next presenter is Fiona Regan. Is a full professor from the Dublin City University in chemistry at the School of. Oh, sorry. Okay. It's okay. Don't worry.
Sorry, did I cut that out?
Yeah, but it's okay, don't worry.
Thanks, Susana.
I start with your presentation. The floor is yours. It's okay, don't worry.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the introduction. As Susana said, I am a professor in Dublin City University in the School of Chemical Sciences, and I'm really delighted to be invited to speak at this webinar, because I suppose citizen science really is a very important part of what we do in the Water Institute. And I'd like to point out that in my presentation on water monitoring enabled by citizen science, I have co-authors Susan Hegarty, Anna Hayes and Ruth Clinton, who have really been, very active in our citizen science work over the last 3 to 4 years. So I suppose the focus of the entire webinar and indeed this engagement is around citizen science. And there are different definitions for what citizen science is. And I suppose we look at the idea of it being community science, engaging communities. And I'll talk about how that is so important for us later on. And also volunteer monitoring. And I think how we engage volunteers is very important. And using, I suppose, online resources is important in terms of water monitoring. When we listen to what Susana was talking about, where she looked at one location, very detailed, very interesting study, with regard to rooftops. What we're looking at is something, I suppose, that is more broadly widespread because it relates to water, and water is moving, continuously moving and picking up pollution as it goes. And so we want to look at really broadening it out. And so for that reason, we need to collect large quantities of data, both spatial and temporal data. And so that's where citizen science really plays an important role here. So you can see the different, applications of citizen science. The really important aspect of this, and I'm an analytical chemist, is that you have a strong scientific question. And so this gives a really good driver to show the need for data collection and how data can be then used, but also to help the citizen understand why they're engaging in this scientific activity. So the strong question is something that really drives what we do. I suppose as well, what's important to understand is what drives us in the Institute, and that would be the goals, the Sustainable Development Goals, principally goal number 6, which relates to water, but water also underpins many of these goals, obviously 14, which looks at life below water and the marine environment, because we approach the work that we do from source to sea, all along the waterways, the river, the surface waters to the sea. And water, of course, affects many other aspects, as I say. So the challenge is, in some instances, resources are a challenge in terms of engaging citizens, in terms of recruiting and training them. In other ways, this can actually slow the development of technologies which are at large enough quantities to be able to engage enough citizens. And where water science is considered here, we need to be able to provide tools that they can use at large enough quantities. And part of what we're trying to show here is the valuable tools that we have that can be easily scaled and easily used. I did say that we want to align our work with the goals, and specifically, we have been showing how our work can link in with SDG 6.3.2. We want to look at how we can monitor water and provide information about water quality that is robust and then can be scaled, not just nationally in Ireland, but internationally. And we'd show how we engage with other agencies in the work that we do. This is a recent publication. If you're interested in looking at some of the data, this is a recent publication that we have published recently. So just to come on to how we have engaged the citizens in the water research that we are doing. Here in the picture, we have two members of the Irish Meteorological Agency met Erin, and on the right is Evelyn Cusack, and really quite a well-known character in Ireland. And we encouraged Evelyn to help us promote this water activity, the citizen science activity. And so we did a lot of pre-planning, we did a lot of social media dissemination, and we really got a huge interest because of the engagement of these, I suppose, personalities. We had an interest from over 800 people to sign up for what we call the Water Blitz. And so from that, then we got a lot of coverage in the media, where we were seen to be monitoring Dublin's water, rivers and canals. Different waterways were being picked up, public were asked to test pollution. Again, you know, these Met-ER and colleagues here. And so the media picked this up because it was quite unique. And so then we were able to participate and show the evidence of the value of the citizens being involved in a water blitz. So this is an example of one that was carried out this year, and there was another one which was carried out 2 years ago. And a blitz occurs over about 4 days. So in total, we had in 2021, 589 samples taken, and in 2019, 342 in different parts of the country. We had over 1,400 participants, compared with over 800 in 2019. And we had 32 catchment areas sampled, compared with 30 in 2019. So you could see a significant scaling up of activities because of the way we approached the engagements of citizens. And the way we approached this was really around looking to groups. And this was really important for us, you know, for citizen science, not to work with individuals. Of course, you'll have individuals, but if you work with groups, they can help with disseminating the information, the training, and also the tools for monitoring. And so we worked with angling groups, river environmental groups, tidy towns groups, which are huge organizations in Ireland. And also schools played a really important role in terms of helping us engage with citizens and have them involved in this really interesting all-island activity over a weekend. So we provided theory and training. We provided these kind of workshop type training events. We provided also field training, where we go with small groups to show them how to use the tools, which I'll go through in a moment. And then we encouraged team sampling. We encouraged for health and safety, but also, I suppose, for more enjoyment for people to work together. Here's an example of a company where we have employees working together to collect samples in the River Liffey in Dublin. Of course, safety comes first, and we provide training on safety, but also reminders always in relation to safety in terms of the water related activities. Prioritizing your own safety, obviously, is critical, and working groups is critical. So this is part of the training that they are given. And I suppose because of COVID as well, we weren't able to have those training events. And so sampling during 2020 didn't really happen for obvious reasons. And safety was one of them. So the types of things that we were measuring was using chemical measurements, chemical measurement kits for nitrates and phosphates, but also observations, ecological observations like land use, pollution sources, vegetation types, presence of algae or foam or oil or litter. And then also a desktop survey looking at things like what is the water type, the land use, water use, aquatic life in the location, and also the hydrological information that they can estimate, maybe using a twig to look at the rate of flow, whether it's surging, whether it's steady. And all of this information could be uploaded very simply using an app immediately, gathering the location information, the GPS code, and then uploaded immediately onto a shared server. The chemical tests, as I say, were for phosphate and nitrate, a very simple tube which had the reagents that we need inside them, and a little small sampler for water sample, and just squeezing the tube allowed suction of the water into the tube, and then you wait for a colour change and you compare. It's a comparator method. You compare the colour in the tube with a card that is provided. And so you have a range then of concentrations that you can record on the app immediately We also provide SeshiDisc, which is used for measuring turbidity or optical clarity in the water. And you can see examples here on the left of different types of water clarity. And you can provide that information also and put that into the app. So within a matter of minutes, you can provide quite a lot of very simply gathered data and put that onto a shared drive. Just some examples of the work that we do. We have a 2-year long study of the River Liffey in a project called Backdrop, which looks at paddleboarders collecting data from the actual river body. So you don't have citizens necessarily collecting water from the sides, while we do, but we encourage water users, so paddleboarders, canoers and so on, collecting water samples from the water itself. And this was really important because now they were able to also observe, you know, inflows into the river that were not observed before. They were able to make observations that up to now we didn't really have information on. So things like storm drains and culverts, they were able to identify them on a map. So the project was sampled. This is a map of Dublin and the River Liffey, which is the main river in the city, and there are other tributaries that feed into Dublin Bay as well. The Dodder and the Talca are shown here, and the River Liffey flows right down into Dublin Bay. And this was used as our sampling site. And then we have various different results plotted on the River Liffey. You can see here for phosphates, the bigger the dot, the higher the level of phosphate. And here for nitrate, the larger the dot, the higher the level of nitrate. And we can see here's a parkland area, higher levels of nitrates around parklands or agricultural lands, and higher levels of phosphates actually occurred where you also had apartments that may not have had proper connections. And so you had flows of phosphates into the river as well in certain locations. So just moving on then, just to show you some examples of the types of sites. The River Liffey is very, very spatey in certain areas and very, very wide and calm in other areas. So it's a very varied type of environment, and it's surrounded then by agricultural land in certain areas. So it's a great urban, rural type site to choose. And interesting, here's one example I just want to show. On the left here is a pipe, and this is where the paddleboarders really were very valuable citizen scientists, because we were able to identify this cloudy or soapy discharge, which was actually a washing machine misconnected. And so you could see the output of the washing machine directly into the river. And this would never be found unless you had these on-river paddleboarders taking part. You can see here the presence of algae and various other observations along the way. So we were able to then map alongside the data that we were getting housing stock. So we were able to look at the planning, the effect of different planning on the river itself. And so we're able to link maybe planning that would have occurred or housing that would have occurred in the period of 2001-2010 during the Celtic Tiger age. So we were able to see the effect of that on certain parts of the river, which is really useful and would never have been achieved without citizen science. So just in summary, the different types of water bodies that were sampled, obviously river waters, but also small streams, which are never monitored usually. And so all of these different small groups were able to engage citizens to give us more information on these small streams than ever would have been achieved before. And as I say, we've got a lot of river catchments, large numbers of participants, large numbers of water samples, and all of these types of groups participated. 2 minutes, okay, thanks. One thing I just want to point out, and I suppose that's relatively unique in terms of what we do, and that is the feedback that we give citizens, which I feel is very important. So these two final slides I think that I have here show the maps that are generated as the citizens upload their information. So basically, each of these dots shows where a citizen has taken a sample. Some areas will have more density than others. As you can see here, this is nitrate data, and this is in the Dublin area. But this information is uploaded in near real time, and these maps are updated in the same period. And so people have access to this and they can see the impact that they are making in near real time. So we provide this feedback readily to the citizen scientist, and they're really, you know, enjoy being engaged in this, in the science, when they can get the information back very quickly. So in conclusion, we find citizen science a really valuable method of improving how we monitor our water bodies in terms of engaging citizens and collection of scientific data. The projects are locally designed. We use, with the help of small groups, they're locally designed, and they also form part of the research project. In our case, it was the backdrop project, which is looking at the effect of misconnections on the rivers. The data is collected, collated and analysed, as I showed you in terms of the maps provided. And it has given us a huge opportunity to fill data gaps and to really improve how we understand and how we monitor and manage our water bodies. So I want to thank everybody involved in the case of the Backdrop Project, RBC, and Earthwatch, who is our partner in this, and of course, acknowledge the Sustainable Development Goals, which is the driver for what we do. And thank you all for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Fiona. It was a very interesting presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So our next presenter is Reed Cassie. She's an associate professor and academic lead for community health in the School of Nursing, Psychotherapy and Community Health at Dublin City University. And her working life as a nurse and academic has involved consistent engagement with groups and individuals who experience marginalization in achieving their health and social potential. So Reed, the floor is yours. Thank you. You can share your presentation.
Great, thank you. Okay, I'll just upload my slides then. Sorry, it's just been a bit slow to upload here. I don't know. It's on the way.
Good.
So I'll just get started. Thanks for the opportunity to present today. My presentation is going to focus around citizen science, but from a particular perspective. The presentations this morning are really interesting, Susana and Sophia and Fiona, and especially in relation to obtaining data, working with people in a participatory way, involving large populations. My research largely focuses on smaller populations, but has a very strong focus on enabling participation and ensuring that really fresh insights come to the fore. So I'll just explain a little bit more. What I'm really talking about in terms of this presentation is citizen social science, which is a form of citizen science, but it has a much stronger focus on this sort of socio-political type environment. It involves citizens in the design or the conduct of social research across all the phases and processes. And it seeks to actually overcome that division between the disciplinary cultures of the humanities and the natural sciences. So it hopes to act as a bridge in that sense. Service users, community groups, and marginalized communities, there's a long tradition of participatory research within social science practice. And I'll just give you some examples of that. And I'm sure people are well familiar with methods such as participatory action research, cooperative inquiry, a whole range of them there. The one that I am going to focus on today is participatory arts research, because I believe that has an awful lot to offer to citizen social science. But also just to bear in mind that there is a very strong wave of patient and public involvement, you know, throughout Europe and internationally, where patients and publics, especially in healthcare, are involved in a contributing to the knowledge field that there is in terms of the actual experience of health and illness and treatments. So I think it's important to bear that in mind as well. A recent survey showed that 80% of current citizen science work or practice is confined to life and natural sciences only. I find this quite interesting, whereas there's only 11% of citizen science projects that look at, you know, are involved in the social science and humanities. And I think that that is something that is really worth considering. You know, is that because, you know, are we using terminology in citizen science that actually doesn't include these kind of participatory methods? Or is it that, you know, they're just maybe not recognized as citizen science? And I wonder, you know, what is the relationship between those two approaches? Certainly some of the features of citizen social science, you know, have an awful lot in common with participatory research. We have the co-creation and the democratization of knowledge, promoting inclusion, building inquiry whenever citizens are actually involved in social science issues. They tend to think a lot more about the issues that are, you know, under consideration. Citizen social science, you know, challenges hegemony and habituated thinking and discourses. Also allowing access to different voices. Typically, the citizens that are involved in this kind of social science participatory research are hard to reach communities or marginalized communities. And also their very involvement in citizen science challenges everyone as researchers to open their methods and to become more flexible. And often there are really brilliant ideas generated from a grassroots level, if you like. So I think it's really important. The area, I suppose, that I'm really interested in is participatory arts-based research, and especially as a method amongst marginalised and hard-to-reach communities, because it offers people a voice. We're not dependent on, you know, logocentric, you know, word and language, you know, written and texts and all of that. So it overcomes barriers of, you know, communication, of language, of literacy, and there's a whole load of other benefits to it as well, which I'll talk about in a minute. Levy talks about it as, you know, people collaborating with research using art as a way of knowing. And, you know, there's been a lot of research that shows arts-based research is in itself a form of inquiry. Actually creating art makes people inquire more into the actual subject that's under scrutiny. So it basically combines participatory action research and arts-based research, uses these various practices as a means of inquiry, as I mentioned before, and enables people to inquire into their life narratives and their histories, a lot of cultural knowledge, a lot of embedded knowledge and embodied knowledge as well that can come out through this process. So I'm going to give you some, I'm just conscious of time being short, so I'm going to give you some examples of what I'm talking about here. So the first one you mightn't be able to see, that's probably quite small writing, but this this was a study that was carried out with my colleagues Colleen O'Neill and Veronica Lambert, and it was around the adolescents' embodied experiences of living with chronic kidney disease. And as you could possibly imagine, you know, young people going through adolescence and their bodies are changing by puberty. They're also experiencing this awful chronic disease, which is also changing their bodies. Their levels of activity, even the way their bodies look, how their bodies feel. And then you have treatment as well, which could be kidney dialysis, where they're hooked up to a machine that takes ownership of their body. Then there's kidney transplants, which, you know, an alien body part comes into that kid's body. So really a question that doesn't get asked in traditional science is, well, what is that experience like? And Fiona mentioned there, you know, having a very strong research question, which is really important. And this was a very strong research question. What is that actual embodied experience like for young people navigating puberty and also disease and treatment? So how we did that was we used participatory arts-based methodology, which is body mapping, which was first done by Solomon in the context of HIV and AIDS as a way of people celebrating their bodies and charting their illnesses, if you like, as well as their strengths. And adolescents actually used this methodology and it involves a load of stages, which I could go into in another presentation. We don't really have time here. But the results of that was that young people really articulated body perceptions, body sensations, experiences that would not have been able to come to light if we had been just using traditional research methods or just interviews or whatever. And I'll show you an example of what I'm talking about here. So here's, you know, an example of one of the body maps. And within this, you can see that the young people recorded a whole range of things, whether it was actual, you know, how they felt about their scars, how they felt about having catheters inserted, what their hopes and dreams were, different things around thirst, the actual lived experience of thirst, tiredness, you know, a whole range, you know, being colonized by a machine, medical interventions, and all of that were really powerfully displayed. And you know, the young people actually generated their own data because it was coming very much as a blank slate, and they were able to produce what was important to them. So they had a lot of ownership over what was actually going to be going into the body maps. And as you can see there, they really used it to the full. And when you compare this to maybe a straightforward standard, you know, semi-structured interview, and you look at the data that these young people have given us, there's not really much of a comparison, I would suggest. And so that was really important to democratize medical knowledge to provide much more insights to healthcare practitioners, but as well as that, for young people as well to come to know their own bodies to a much greater extent. Then the second study that I just want to share with you, and this is where, I mean, a lot of our citizen science projects can be, you know, top down, you know, where the researcher comes up with ideas and then they go out to a population. This was an actual bottom up approach with an agency that we would have close working relationships with in DCU, and it's the SEAL project, which is a project for women affected by addiction and poverty, and we work together with them to produce knowledge around the whole area of poverty, really. So basically, a brief description of that project is that they themselves, the project, the women and the staff within the project decided, because a lot of them were experiencing poverty, so they decided, well, we'll just find out what do people think about poverty. So they, you know, took it up on themselves, which is fantastic, and off they went and asked people from a whole range of areas, what object do you think represents poverty? So they took photographic images, and as you can see there, they had the images blown up, and they had an urban art exhibition. And I think it's really interesting, you know, Fiona was showing photographs there of the Liffey in terms of water quality, and here is the Liffey in the background, the River Liffey in Dublin, which is a backdrop to the urban art exhibition. So the Liffey is featured very strongly in our presentations today. So this was the urban art exhibition, and you can see there, that's the president of Ireland. You might know him already, maybe Michael D. Higgins. And he came along to see this urban art exhibition. So it gives the public a chance to engage with these objects of poverty. And of course, it's a play on abject poverty, which was really interesting. So so what we did then was that, and this is where I worked more with this project than where we linked in with them. And the women came in to DCU and worked. We worked together in a collaborative way with our student nurses, whereby they brought the images in with them. And we split into workshop groups and we discussed the various images. So if it was an empty plate, as you can see there, we discussed things like food poverty. If it was a needle, we were discussing things like addiction. You know, there was a button hanging by a thread. So we talked about mental health. So there was a whole kind of range. And the students actually talked about their experiences of all of these things as well. So it was very open and democratic. And so you can see there's an example of how we were brainstorming some of these things, where you can see a key, and that was one of the symbols. And, you know, some of the comments that people were making about it, you know, we used things like post-its and conversations to get a body of knowledge. This little piece, if I have time for 2 seconds, just to let you read that, maybe, if you can. And this was the empty plate. And like this, to me, really show it embodies, you know, what it's like to actually live in a hotel and to try to provide for your kids. And I think that, you know, images and metaphors really, really evoke so much amongst people who are actually participating.
Okay.
So it brings those experiences much, makes them much more real. And then we had the exhibition launch, which you can see there. And then some of the evaluations then of this particular project from various stakeholders within the project and various contributors. And you can read that themselves. And what was really interesting was that poverty was not just located in these poor women from this project. The students talked, student nurses talked about their own poverty. And the women had had perceptions of nurses and student nurses as being, oh, look at you, they're grand, they're well off, they're well to do. But actually through this project, you know, the women realized that also sometimes the student nurses didn't have enough money to get their dinner or to keep warm or whatever. Now, obviously, there was much bigger issues around women's poverty and addiction and all of that as well. But there were great discussions around mental health and all of this. So they realized that they actually had so many things in common, while a lot of awful socioeconomic issues as well amongst the women. So the benefits, you know, really was the whole thing about contributing to debate and learning, you know, developing these shared understandings and knowledge, breaking down the stereotypes and stigma that each group may have had of each other, and developing capacity, critical thinking and confidence. And, you know, the women from the project as well become more comfortable in academic learning contexts. And indeed, the students go out on placement into the CL project and other projects as well. So there's a mix on the other side of things as well. And in fact, two of the women have since come to study in DCU as a result of that project. Some of the challenges then, you know, participation, preconceptions, I mentioned this already, but overall it was a fantastic project. And so the implications for citizen science practice, you know, that basically we need to have this dialogue with people. And I suppose that it's not, you know, it's not just big scale projects, but it's also about getting in depth as well as breadth. We need depth as well. And I suppose my suggestion is that participatory arts approaches, you know, offer really powerful methods of engaging diverse groups and to help us to develop research practice and knowledge development. So thank you. Thanks for that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Ruth. It was very inspiring and interesting. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay.
So now we have two more presenters. The first one is Pedro Besa. So you will do the presentation together or it's separate?
Together.
Together.
Yeah, together.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so it will be Pedro Besa and Monica Aresta from the University of Aveiro. So thank you very much. The floor is yours. Thank you. You are mute. Pedro, you are mute.
Sorry, can you hear now? Yeah, okay. We'll try. Let's see how it goes. We try to present the both of us the presentation. We are presenting here a project little different from the previous. We are focused on how different strategies to engage the participants and the users based on the environmental issues. So the focus of this presentation is that the Gamers for Nature project. This project has different participants. We are working with researchers from communication technologies. This is our case. Me and Monica work on Digimedia. We work with designers, with environment and biologists, and we are working also with the NGO. And those are the researchers that were on the beginning of the project. Our context of to start the project is not, this is not new information. Every country in the world, the population focus on urban areas. Here in Portugal, we have the most of the population is in large cities near the coast. We see young people disconnection with the nature. Although in the last years we saw some movements regarding the Greta Thunberg movement. But we'll see a lot of disconnection of the student with the youngsters with the nature, and this disconnection has short and long impact on their lives and the planet. So we try also to understand the communication, the importance of the biodiversity and nature. Balance through to those public. Our starting point of this project was the need to promote the environmental awareness in youngsters, how to use the power of the games, especially digital games. We have in the I think maybe 5 years ago, we have the example of the Pokemon Go, when we start to see a lot of youngsters and groups on the city walking, playing the game. So we try to use that strategy, and we try also to use the mobile phone as an interface to communicate and to engage the population. We tried to connect those dots, and that was the basis of the project. How to engage and to involve the younger audience in mobile game creation, and by doing that, trying to promote the environmental awareness. Our difference from the different research and examples that we study is that the process of engaging the students, because we work with students in the creation of the digital game, make the difference, because the process of appropriation and creation of their own object related to a thematic context. But one of the difficulties that we predicted on this process was the need of skills and information to create the digital game and to understand the thematic context. During the project, we developed a set of resources that we put together on the toolkit that we named as a Gamers for Nature toolkit, and that toolkit helped the students to create their own game. For the starting point of the project was this. Now Monica will present a little in more detail the toolkit. Then we return for the project results.
Okay, I will share my screen now. Okay, just give me 1 second, please. Okay. Here and this one. Pedro, I'm not able to share my content. I don't know if I need to have any specific permission. Let's see now.
Okay, I can share here, and I control the presentation.
Okay, thank you.
Just 1 minute, please. No.
I don't know if it's about network connection, but I really am not able to share my presentation.
We were seeing the presentation, Pedro, but I don't know the one that you presented before.
Okay, so you are seeing Pedro's screen. Okay, because I'm only seeing your faces.
No, not anymore.
Not because before. I stopped presenting.
Okay.
That's a problem of the trying to do that presentation into
computers.
I think you are seeing now. Yes?
Yes.
Yeah?
Okay. I'm not seeing it yet, but I believe I will follow from the screens I have on my side. It's probably a problem of my Teams connection. So I believe you are seeing the screen with the toolkit to game design. We wanted to engage younger audiences in the creation and developing of digital games, but we were aware, as Pedro said, that some of them were not familiar with the game design process or had no knowledge on how to create a game. So we have developed
We don't hear you now.
Okay, I will continue because I stopped here also, but I didn't know if it was a problem of my computer. Okay, so what Monica was presenting is that we predicted a difficulty for the students to create the digital game because there is information needed.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Okay, sorry, it was really my connection here. So the toolkit Gamers for Nature, it comprises a collection of resources that were developed to encourage and to support the participation of younger audiences in the development of mobile games. It's an analogic toolkit that is, well, it's a cardboard box with several cards that allow our audiences, our participants, to create game narratives. The toolkit has a game construction card set that, it gives participants or the users information about all the games, all the elements we must consider when creating a game. For instance, the premise, the narrative, the story, the challenge, the outcome. There are 12 cards. Each one corresponds or is an adaptation of Fullerton's game design elements. It's based on her approach to game design. And on the cards, on the front face of the cards, we have a question that allows users to think about that game element. For instance, the premise, usually our participants, they kind of ignore the word premise, but start to think, how does the story of our game begin? Or how do we keep our player engaged? And on the back of the card, there is information on how to use the game element and how to use it in the construction of the game narrative. We also have a rapid game design document that it is a kind of a proposal or a path, some guidelines, let's say it, on how to use the game creation card set. This rapid game design document was created along and because of the game design sessions. At first, we gave all our participants the 12 cards for them to create the game narrative. But even participants that were used or familiar with playing games did not know how to start exploring the game elements and to create the game narrative. So by observing several focus groups that we have made, several testing groups that we have engaged with, where participants were invited to use the cards, we have established or analyzed all the interaction with the cards and established this kind of proposal or a path for users to use the game construction card set, starting with the narrative elements, the story, the premise, the character, then working towards the player, the challenge, the rules, and the outcome. As Pedro said, the toolkit was created to foster the development of environmental awareness. So our intention is for participants or students, younger audiences, to create a game that addresses an environmental theme. We do not want, it's not a game-based learning approach. We do not want students to play games. We want them to create games. And while creating the game, story, the narrative, the challenge, they will be interacting with information about that environmental awareness theme. But we are totally aware of the misinformation that spreads all around the internet and the myths that students usually have when dealing with environmental information. So we have created thematic card sets. This one is one of our sets, microplastic pollution cards, that has specific, curated and authentic information about this environmental problem. We have divided all the information that we have collected about this theme in four categories. Did you know that, for instance, microplastics are particles? But after all, what do microplastics come of? Is it true that there are microplastics in my food? Say no to microbeads. Each category of information provides facts about the theme, facts, information about the process, how microplastics come up, how do we discard microplastics, some myths that still emerge about that environmental awareness theme, and information, or what we call take action, small steps that can lead to big changes in what concerns protecting the environment. Okay.
We have a short video. Maybe we can for now skip it and then
yes, because of time.
If you have the time. Okay.
Okay, now this toolkit was used, it was first test, and now it is being used in several game creation sessions with upper secondary and university students. We have sessions that have lasted 1 day, 5 to 6 hours. Some have lasted 2 days. We have used it in long-term creation sessions and also in a 72 online hours game jam. Upper secondary students and school students, we have already engaged 53 students in these game creation sessions. 1 day sessions, it were 2 sessions with this typology, 1 day session. And with these 53 students, they were able to create 22 playable prototypes of digital games addressing an environmental awareness theme. In what concerns university students, we have been using it on a bachelor's degree, I believe that's how we say it, in Lab Multimedia 3, and we have engaged 165 students. that along the course were challenged to learn more about how to program and how to use specific programming languages, and on the last month of the semester were challenged to create a game addressing the environmental awareness theme using all those programming languages. As a result of this activity, the outcome was 38 playable prototypes of digital games. University students were also engaged in a 72 hours online game jam, where the game development session was made along the online game jam. It started on a Friday evening and it lasted until Sunday morning, early afternoon. And as a result, we had 9 participants and we had 6 playable prototypes of digital games. We also have used these our audiences, which already are upper secondary students and university students, so they are somehow used to deal with technology, and some of them might have some programming language knowledges. But we also have used the toolkit on a more simple and user-centered design approach with primary education students, 6 to 11 years old, 14 primary education students that have along an afternoon created a game addressing microplastic pollution. They used Scratch. It was a language they were already familiar with, but they did not know how to create a game. They were aware of the theme, microplastic pollution. They knew Scratch, but they never created a game. We gave them tutorials, what we call the modding process. We gave them games for them to change using Scratch. And we had, 8 digital games with sharks and plastic bags. Well, the narrative was very simple, but they were able to say, and by the end of the day, they were able to say, okay, so my toothpaste may have microplastic beads. I really need to be careful about this. I will tell my mom and my father to be aware of what we are buying to our home. We are also using the toolkit in another project, an Erasmus Plus project. We have engaged students from secondary schools from Ireland, Hungary, Spain, and Bragança here in Portugal. Our dissemination partner is the Serious Game Society in Italy. BioLiving is our partner, and it has a coordination of University of Aveiro. And we have engaged 26, I believe. Just let me check here. Okay, thank you. And we have engaged 26 students in these game creation activities.
So now we are deciding the next steps. That's why we are participating on these sessions and try to engage students or youngsters with different age ranges. The main focus was on youngsters, but it's not an experience, but the work that we have done with the small children, the results were we consider very, very positive. So very we try to work with different ages and try to work with different thematic contexts. For example, try to connect with the STEAM, because our approach is to engage the participants in the creation of digital games and with a thematic context. So the thematic context can be almost anything. And now we are on the open road. Let's see how it goes, this project. So thank you for your time. Okay. Sorry about those presentation errors, but we hope that does not compromise your understanding of the project. So if we have 2 minutes, we can share the video. I don't know if we have the time.
Yes, if you want, you can. We can share the video, and then there won't be any time for.
Okay. No. For the on the presentation there is the link, so you can see it later.
Oh, okay, as you wish. I just wanted to remind you again that in the first week of February we will have a workshop to come together. So the researchers from the whole ECIU University are welcome to attend to this workshop, and to be able to together develop some proposals of citizen science pilots that are going to be funded by the SMARTER project. So, yes, I just welcome you to be updated on this very soon, so that you can join us in February.
Okay, so I don't know, Sofia, if we have time for any question or we have to close the session.
As anyone, if you are available for one question or
somebody has.
Can I ask a question to Susana, if there is the time?
Yes.
In your study. There was any kind of initiatives from the citizens with the green gardens, with the production of vegetables, or there is no type of these activities?
Okay, so in this case, in the first one, that is Badia del Vallès, this municipality, They already have some different gardens, okay, but not on the rooftop. They have on soil, okay, because this is a housing estate, and usually housing estates have very open space between the buildings. So they are using this part. They have this land to have some gardens, mainly. Mainly old people, like senior people have this kind of hobbies or so they have this part, and in our case we propose to use the rooftop of their buildings. So this is for agriculture, it's a little bit more complicated. For example, for this reason they mainly vote for implementing PV panels. Okay, so there are something, but it's still in these kind of constructions, there are a lot of space on their rooftops, and usually they don't use. Also, I live in a building with a very big rooftop and nobody uses. So this was our proposal, but mainly they visualize PV panels or something like this, like photovoltaic panels in their rooftop. Because agriculture, they have some land to do some urban agriculture. So they have still in this municipality. Now we are working with another municipality, and also they have some different initiatives. In fact, I have a workshop today, this afternoon, with this new municipality in order to explain different results and to see what they think, what they propose, something like this.
Okay.
Thank you. So another, and just a small comment or question. I don't know if it was the same for you, for Bridge or Fiona or Pedro or Monica. I don't know, because there are different stakeholders that you were working. But for example, for me, in this municipality, it was very difficult to engage citizens. It was very difficult because at the end, the only people that came to this different participatory process mainly were men and old people, like senior citizens. Because young people, it was very difficult for me. And also, I was asking for help for the city council and also some different associations. I don't know if it's the same for you or if you have any advice for me, whatever. Thank you.
I can, Susanna, I can perhaps comment. I agree, it is difficult to engage citizens. But what we have learned over the course of maybe 3 years is to already work with groups of community groups who have an interest in a particular topic. For us, it was, you know, it made more sense to work with River Trust groups and community groups. But even things like school groups or scouts, you know, organizations like to have a project. So if you can get the names of leaders of groups, it's a great way to make sure that people will deliver. So the responsibility is not all on you. And that they then can, you know, work together. So yeah, I think being a little bit more targeted in how you approach the citizens is, we have found that to be beneficial.
You know, in our case, what we try to minimize that problem, we work with the NGO, the BioLiving Association, that is an environmental association. They work a lot with volunteer works, so we try to engage the participants through the association, because on the daily activities they also have the contact with the volunteers, with different groups, so we try to use them as to help us to reach the participants, because on the schools and here on the university is more easy, because we try to use the classes to reach the students, but it's different because everything that is on formal context has a different engagement of the students, but we try to have a more informal contact with the department, but It's not easy.
Yeah, I agree. I think it can be really challenging to find participants and to engage with them. And I think that point about knowing the community and knowing particular groups is really important. But I suppose the other thing I would add to it is in terms of the methodology of the project, of really just making sure that the methodology that you're going to use if for involving people in gathering or generating the data or the information is something that suits them and that is easy for them to use, or something that they really buy into, or that it means something to them as well, I think is another really important thing. You know, I'm really struck by the gaming technology piece. I find that really interesting because I think it's, you know, where people generate their own data is very, very powerful, because then people can see the results of what it is that they're doing. And it, again, I think in the other projects that came across really strongly as well, whenever participants or co-researchers get to see what they're actually producing and get to know what the impacts of that might be on in a particular community, I think that can be very affirming for people as well.
Thank you. Also, we have a hand here. Daniela, want to add something? Hello, Daniela.
Hey, me. I just couldn't stay quiet because today we had the most interesting topics for me for citizen science and science communication also, because I have had science communication with kids. And we have here the environmental issues because it's my area of scientific career. But we also have the arts and multimedia technology.
We don't hear you now, Daniela.
Have them as partners. I will have a presentation next week, and we'll see that in schools to have the environmental data, the right and everything on the right day or everything right, is using the schools and the teachers because they are a big group, and we ensure that the data gets right to us through the platforms because they have the digital skills to do that. If we use everyone, it's not very easy. The challenges for digital accessibility, it's very hard to deal with them. So it's very important to have the engagement part and through technology and arts. Because the youngest is very easy to work with them and provide scientific information through arts, I believe. So it's very effective. So I think today we had the keys to do something very interesting for everyone, including the youth. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniela. So I think we have to close the session. Thank you very much for our presenters and also the participants. And I don't know, see you on February, maybe in February.
Yes, and also in the following webinars that are coming. So we have still one on the next week on Monday, and then two more in February, in January before the workshop in February.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Bye.